Presidents, trustees, faculty, staff, and students from the 28 Jesuit universities here present. Fathers Provincial, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I should like to thank you for your welcome. I hope that after my speech, you still applaud as much. The Conference on the Commitment to Justice in American Jesuit Higher Education comes at an important moment in the rich history of the 28 colleges and universities represented here this evening. We also join Santa Clara University in celebrating the 105th anniversary of its founding. Just as significant as at this moment in history is our location. Santa Clara Valley, named after the mission at the heart of this campus, is known worldwide as Silicon Valley, the home of the microchip. Surely, when Father Nobili, the founder of this university, saw the destroyed church and compound of the former Franciscan mission, he could never have imagined this valley as the center of a global technological revolution. This juxtaposition of mission and microchip is emblematic of all the Jesuit schools. Originally founded to serve the educational and religious needs of a poor immigrant population, they have become highly sophisticated institutions of learning in the midst of global wealth, power, and culture. The turn of the millennium finds them in all the diversity. They are larger, better equipped, more complex and professional than ever before, and also more concerned about their Catholic Jesuit identity. In the history of American Jesuit higher education, there is much to be grateful for, first to the Lord and His Church, and surely to the many faculty, students, administrators, trustees, and benefactors who have made it what it is today. But this conference brings you together from across the United States with guests from Jesuit universities elsewhere, not to congratulate one another, but for a strategic purpose. On behalf of the complex, professional, and pluralistic institutions you represent, you are here to face a question in the United States as difficult as it is central. How can Jesuit universities and colleges in the United States express faith-filled concern for justice in what they are as Christian academies of higher learning, in what their faculty do and what their students should become? As a contribution to your answer, I would like to reflect with you on what faith and justice has meant for Jesuits since 1975. Consider some concrete circumstances of today, and then to suggest what justice rooted in faith could mean in American Jesuit higher education. First of all, this Jesuit commitment in 1975. 25 years ago, 10 years after the closing of the Second Vatican Council, Jesuit delegates from around the world gathered at the 32nd General Congregation to consider how the society was responding to the deep transformation of all church life that was called for and started by Vatican II. After much prayer and deliberation, the congregation slowly realized that the entire Society of Jesus, in all its many works, was being invited by the Spirit to set out on a new direction. The overriding purpose of the Society of Jesus, namely the service of faith, must also include the promotion of justice. This new direction was not confined to those already working with the poor and marginalized in what was called the social apostolate. Rather, this commitment was to be a concern of our whole life and a dimension of all our apostolic endeavors. So central to the mission of the entire society was this union of faith and justice that it was to become the integrating factor of all the society's work, and in this light, great attention was to be paid in evaluating every work, including educational institutions. As you heard already from Brad, I myself attended the 32nd General Congregation representing the province of the Near East, where for centuries the apostolic activity of the Jesuits has concentrated on education in a famous university in Beirut and some outstanding high schools in Egypt, Syria, and Lebanon. Of course, some Jesuits worked in very poor villages, refugee camps or prisons, and some fought for the rights of workers, immigrants, and foreigners, but this was not always considered authentic, mainstream Jesuit work. In Beirut, we were well aware that there were problems in our university with justice. The medical school was staffed by very holy Jesuits, but it was producing, at least I hope at that time, some of the most corrupt citizens in the city, but this was taken for granted. The social mood of the explosive Near East did not favor a struggle against sinful, unjust structures. The liberation of Palestine was the most important social issue. And the Christian churches, all minorities, had committed themselves to many works of charity, but involvement in the promotion of justice would have tainted them by association with leftist movements and political turmoil. The situation I describe in the Near East was not exceptional in the worldwide society at that time. I was not the only delegate who was completely ignorant of matters pertaining to justice and injustice. The Synod of Bishops in 1971 had prophetically declared, and I quote, "Action on behalf of justice and participation in the transformation of the world fully appear to us as a constitutive dimension of the preaching of the gospel, or in other words, of the Church's mission for the redemption of the human race and its liberation from every oppressive situation." But few of us knew what this meant in our concrete life conditions. Earlier in 1966, Father Arupe had pointed out to the Latin American provincials how the socio-economic situation throughout the continent contradicted the gospel, and from this situation rises the moral obligation of the society to rethink all its ministries and every form of its apostolates to see if they really offer an answer to the urgent priorities which justice and social equity call for. Many of us failed to see the relevance of his message to our concrete situation. But please note that Father Arupe never asked it for the suppression of the apostolate of education in favor of social activity. On the contrary, he affirmed that even an apostolate like education, and that at all levels, which is so sincerely wanted by the society and whose importance is clear to the entire world, in its concrete forms today, must be the object of reflection in the light of the demands of the social problem. Perhaps the incomprehension or reluctance of some of us delegates was one reason why the 32nd General Congregation finally took a very radical stand. With a passion both inspiring and disconcerting, the General Congregation coined the formula, the service of faith and the promotion of justice, and used it well to push every Jesuit work and every individual Jesuit to make a choice, providing little leeway for the faint-hearted. Many inside and outside the society were outraged by the promotion of justice. As Father Arupe rightly perceived, his Jesuits were collectively entering upon a more severe way of the cross, which would surely entail misunderstandings and even opposition on the part of civil and ecclesiastical authorities, many good friends, and some of our own members. Today, 25 years later, this option has become integral to our Jesuit identity, to the awareness of our mission, and to our public image in both church and human society. The summary expression, the service of faith and the promotion of justice, has all the characteristics of a world-conquering slogan, using a minimum of words to inspire a maximum of dynamic vision, but at the risk of linguistic ambiguity. Let us examine first the service of faith and then the promotion of justice. From our origins in 1540, the society has been officially and solemnly charged with the defense and the propagation of the faith. In 1995, the congregation reaffirmed that for us Jesuits, the defense and propagation of faith is a matter of to be or not to be, even if the words themselves can change. Faithful to the Vatican Council, the congregation wanted our preaching and teaching not to proselytize, not to impose our religion on others, but rather to propose in our way of living Jesus and his message of God's kingdom in a spirit of love to everyone. Just as the Vatican itself had abandoned the name Propaganda Fidei, the 32nd General Congregation passed from propagation to service of faith. In Decree 4, the congregation did use the expression the proclamation of faith, which personally I preferred. In the context of centuries of Jesuit spirituality, however, the service of faith cannot mean anything other than to bring the countercultural gift of Christ to our world. But why the service of faith? The congregation itself answers this question by using the Greek expression diakonia fidei. It refers to a word that was very in at that time, diakonia, and as it already meant in classical Greek, it is a committed mission to bring and to serve a table. Now, in Christian language, it became the image of Christ himself, who came from the Father to serve us at table, the Word of God, the bread of life, and also the daily bread. It refers to Christ, the suffering servant, carrying out his diakonia in total service of his Father by laying down his life for the salvation of all of us. For a Jesuit, not just any answer to the needs of the women and men of today will do. The initiative must come from the Lord, laboring in events and people here and now. It is the Lord who invites us to follow Christ in his labors, on his terms, and in his way. I do not think that we delegates at the 32nd congregation were aware of the theological and ethical dimensions of Christ's mission of service. Greater attention to this diakonia may have prevented some of the misunderstandings provoked by the phrase, the promotion of justice. This expression is difficult to translate in many languages. We delegates were familiar with sales promotions in a department store or the promotion of friends or enemies to a higher rank or position. We were not familiar with the promotion of justice. To be fair, let us remember that a general congregation is not a scientific academy equipped to distinguish and to define, to clarify and to classify. In the face of radically new apostolic needs, it chose to inspire, to teach, and even to prophesy. In its desire to be more incisive in the promotion of justice, the congregation avoided traditional words like charity, mercy, or love. Also, it did not speak about development or relief. That would not do. The congregation instead used the word promotion with its connotation of a well-planned strategy to make the world just. Since St. Ignatius wanted love to be expressed not only in words, but also in deeds, the congregation committed the society to the promotion of justice as a concrete, radical, but proportionate answer to an unjustly suffering world. Fostering the virtue of justice in people was not enough. Only a substantive justice can bring about the kinds of structural and attitudinal changes that are needed to uproot those sinful, oppressive injustices that are a scandal against humanity, as John Paul II repeated. This sort of justice requires an action-oriented commitment to the real poor, with a courageous personal option. In some ears, the relatively mild expression promotion of justice echoed revolutionary, subversive, and even violent language. Just as in diakonia fidei, service of faith, the term faith, Catholic, Christian, or others, is not specified, so in the promotion of justice, the term justice also remained ambiguous, and this was necessary to vote for it. The 32nd congregation would not have voted for Decree 4 if, on the one hand, socio-economic justice had been excluded, or if, on the other hand, the justice of the gospel had not been included. A stand in favor of social justice that was almost ideological and political, and simultaneously a strong option for that justice of the gospel which embodies God's love and saving mercy, were both indispensable. Refusing to clarify the relationship between the two, the 32nd General Congregation maintains its radicality by simply juxtaposing diaconia fidei and promotion of justice. It is true that during the General Congregation, some tried, by proposing amendments, a more integrated expression, such as the service of faith through or in the promotion of justice. Such expressions might better render the synods in the identification of action on behalf of justice and participation in the transformation of the world. But one can understand the congregation's fear that too neat or integrated an approach might weaken the prophetic appeal and water down the radical change that was necessary in our mission. In retrospect, this simple juxtaposition sometimes led to an incomplete, slanted, and unbalanced reading of Decree 4, unilaterally emphasizing only one aspect of this mission to the detriment of the other, treating faith and justice as alternative or even rival tracks of ministry. Dogmatism or ideology sometimes led us to treat each other more as enemies than as companions. The promotion of justice has sometimes been separated from its wellspring of faith. On the one side, the faith dimension was too often presumed and left implicit, as if our identity as Jesuits were enough. Some rushed headlong towards the promotion of justice without much analysis or discernment or reflection, and with only occasional reference to the justice of the gospel. They seemed to consign the serving of faith to a dying past. Those, on the other side, clung to a certain style of faith and church. They gave the impression that the Lord's grace had to do only with the next life, and that divine reconciliation entailed no practical obligation to set things right already here on earth. In this frank assessment, I'd like to demonstrate how, over the last 25 years, the Lord has patiently been teaching us to serve the faith that does justice in a more integral way. In the midst of radical statements and unilateral interpretations associated with Decree 4, many raised doubts about our maintaining large educational institutions. They insinuated, if they did not insist, that direct social work among the poor and involvement with the movement should take absolute priority. Today, however, the value of the educational apostolate is generally recognized also in the active social ministry, being the sector occupying the greatest Jesuit manpower and resources, but only on condition that it transform its goals, contents, and methods. Even before the 32nd General Congregation, Father Arupe had already fleshed out the meaning of diaconia fidei for educational ministries when he told in 1973 International Congress of Jesuit Alumni of Europa what follows. Today, our prime educational objective must be to form women and men for others, women and men who will live not for themselves, but for the Lord and His Christ, for the God-man who lived and died for all the world, women and men who cannot even conceive of love of God, which does not include love for the least of their neighbors, women and men completely convinced that love of God, which does not issue in justice for humanity, is a farce. My predecessor's address was not well received by many alumni at this Valencia meeting. But the expression "women and men for others" really helped the educational institutions of the society to ask serious questions that led to their transformation. Father Ignacio de la Curia, in his 1982 convocation address here at Santa Clara University, eloquently expressed his conviction in favor of the promotion of justice in the educational apostolate. He said, "A Christian university must take into account the gospel preference for the poor. This does not mean that only the poor study at the university. It does not mean that the university should abdicate its mission of academic excellence. Excellence needed in order to solve complex social problems. It does mean that the university should be present intellectually where it is needed. To provide science for those who have no science, to provide skills for the unskilled, to be a voice for those who do not possess the academic qualifications to promote and legitimate their rights." In these two statements, we discover the same concern to go beyond in this incarnate spiritualism or in secular social activism, so as to renew the educational apostolate in word and in action at the service of the Church in a world many times of unbelief and certainly of injustice. We should be very grateful for all that has been achieved in this educational apostolate, both faithful to the characteristics of 400 years of Ignatian education and open to the changing signs of the times. Today, one or two generations after Decree 4, we face a world that has an even greater need for the faith that does justice. I should now say a few words about the specific condition in which this educational responsibility has to take place. But as a guest of the United States, you understand that I will not enter too much in United States presidential campaigns. So I will just make two observations about the conditions in which this all has to be done. First of all, meeting in Silicon Valley brings to mind not only the intersection of mission and microchip, but also the dynamism and even dominance that are characteristics of the United States at this time. This is the headquarters of the new economy that reaches around the globe and is transforming the basic fabric of business, work, and communications. Thousands of immigrants arrive from everywhere, entrepreneurs from Europe, high-tech professionals from South Asia who staff the service industries, as well as workers from Latin America and Southeast Asia who do the physical labor, a remarkable ethnic, cultural, and class diversity. At the same time, the United States struggles with new social divisions aggravated by the digital divide between those with access to the world of technology and those left out. This rift, with its causes in class, racial, and economic differences, has its root cause in chronic discrepancies in the quality of education. Here in Silicon Valley, for example, some of the world's best research universities flourish alongside struggling public schools where Afro-American and immigrant students drop out in droves. Nationwide, one child in every six is condemned to ignorance and poverty. A second feature: thanks to science and technology, human society is able to solve problems such as feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, or developing more just conditions of life, but remains stubbornly unable to accomplish this. How can a booming economy, the most prosperous and global ever, still leave over half of humanity in poverty? The 30th General Congregation makes its own sober analysis and moral assessment when it says, "We can no longer pretend that the injustices of our world must be borne as part of the inevitable order of things. It is now quite apparent that the order result of what the human person himself, the human person in his selfishness, has done. Despite the opportunities offered by an ever more serviceable technology, we are simply not willing to pay the price of a more just and more human society. Injustice, finally, is rooted in a spiritual problem, and its solution requires a spiritual conversion of each one's heart and a cultural conversion of our global society, so that humankind, with all the powerful means at its disposal, might exercise the will to change the sinful structures afflicting our world. The yearly Human Development Report of the United Nations is a haunting challenge to look critically at the basic conditions of life in the United States and the 175 other nations that share our one planet. Such is the world in all its complexity, with great global promises and countless tragic betrayals. Such is the world in which Jesuit institutions of higher education are called to serve faith and promote justice. Within the complex time and place we are in, and in the light of the recent General Congregation, I want to spell out several ideal characteristics as manifest in three complementary dimensions of Jesuit higher education: in who our students become, in what our faculty do, and in how our universities proceed. When I speak about ideals, some are easy to meet, others remain persistently challenging, but together they serve to orient our schools and in the long run to identify them. At the same time, the United States provincials have recently established an important higher education committee to propose criteria on the staffing, leadership, and Jesuit sponsorship of our colleges and universities. May these criteria help to implement the ideal characteristics we now meditate shortly on together. First, formation and learning. Today's predominant ideology reduces the human world to a global jungle whose primordial law is the survival of the fittest. Students who subscribe to this view want to be equipped with well-honed professional and technical skills in order to compete in the market and secure one of the relatively scarce, fulfilling, and lucrative jobs available. This is the success which many students and their parents expect from us. All American universities, ours included, are under tremendous pressure to opt entirely for success in this sense. But what our students want and deserve includes, but goes beyond, this worldly success based on marketable skills. The real measure of our Jesuit universities lies in who our students become. For 450 years, Jesuit education has sought to educate the whole person, intellectually and professionally, psychologically, morally, and spiritually. Tomorrow's whole person can be whole without an educated awareness of society and culture, with which to contribute socially, generously, in the real world. Tomorrow's whole person must have, in brief, a well-educated solidarity. We must therefore raise our Jesuit educational standard to educate the whole person of solidarity for the real world. Solidarity is learned through contact rather than through concepts, as John Paul II said recently at an Italian university conference. When the heart is touched by direct experience, the mind may be challenged to change. Personal involvement with innocent suffering, with the injustice others suffer, is the catalyst for solidarity, which then gives rise to intellectual inquiry and moral reflection. Students in the course of their formation must let the gritty reality of this world into their lives so they can learn to feel it, think about it critically, respond to its suffering, and engage it constructively. They should learn to perceive, think, judge, choose, and act for the rights of others, especially the disadvantaged and the oppressed. Campus ministry does much to foment such intelligent, responsible, and active compassion, compassion that deserves the name solidarity. Our universities also boast a splendid variety of in-service programs, outreach programs, insertion programs, off-campus contacts, and hands-on courses. These should not be too optional, but at the core of every Jesuit university program of studies. We pass now to research and teaching. If the measure and purpose of our universities lies in what the students become, then the faculty are at the heart of our universities. Their mission is tirelessly to seek the truth and to form each student into a whole person of solidarity who will take responsibility for the real world. What do they need in order to fulfill this essential vocation? The faculty's research, which must be rigorous, firmly rooted in faith, and open to dialogue with all people of goodwill, not only obeys the canons of each discipline, but ultimately embraces human reality in order to help make the world a more fitting place for 6 billion of us to inhabit. I want to affirm that university knowledge is valuable for its own sake, and at the same time is knowledge that must ask itself, for whom, for what? Usually we speak of professors in the plural, but what is at stake is more than the sum of so many individual commitments and efforts. It is a sustained interdisciplinary dialogue of research and reflection, a continuous pooling of expertise. The purpose is to assimilate experiences and insights according to their different disciplines in a vision of knowledge which, well aware of its limitations, is not satisfied with fragments, but tries to integrate them into a true and wise synthesis about the real world. Unfortunately, many faculty still feel academically, humanly, and I would say spiritually, unprepared for such an exchange. And for that reason, this meeting is so important. To make sure that the real concerns of the poor find their place in research, faculty members need an organic collaboration with those in the church and in the human society who work among and for the poor and actively seek justice. They should be involved together in all aspects: presence among the poor, designing the research, gathering the data, thinking through problems, planning and action, doing evaluation and theological reflection. Just as the students need the poor in order to learn, so the professors need partnerships with the social apostolate in order to research and teach and form. Such partnerships do not turn Jesuit universities into branch plants of social ministries or agencies of social change, as certain rhetoric of the past may have led some to fear, but are a pledge of the faculty's option and really help, as the colloquial expression goes, to keep your feet to the fire. When faculty do take up interdisciplinary dialogue and socially engaged research in partnership with social ministries, they are exemplifying and modeling knowledge which is service, and the students learn by imitating them as masters of life and of moral commitment, as John Paul II likes to say. Finally, our way of proceeding in the universities. If the measure of our universities is who the students become, and if the faculty are the heart of it all, then what is there left to say? It is perhaps the third topic, the character of our universities, how they proceed internally, and how they impact on society, which is the most difficult. We have already dwelt on the importance of formation and learning, of research and training. The social action that the students undertake and the socially relevant work that the professors do are vitally important and necessary, but these do not add up to the full character of a Jesuit university. They neither exhaust its face justice commitment nor really fulfill its responsibilities to society. In the words of the 34th General Congregation, a Jesuit university must be faithful to both the known university and to the adjective Jesuit. To be a university requires dedication to research, teaching, and the various forms of service that correspond to its cultural mission. To be Jesuit requires that the university act in harmony with the demands of the service of faith and promotion of justice. The first way, historically, that our universities began living out their faith justice commitment was through their admissions policies, affirmative action for minorities, and scholarships for disadvantaged students. And these continue to be effective means. An even more telling expression of the Jesuit university's nature is found in policies concerning hiring and tenure. As a university, it is necessary to respect the established academic, professional, and labor norms. But as Jesuit, it is also essential to go beyond them and find ways of attracting, hiring, and promoting those who actively share the mission. I believe that we have made considerable Jesuit efforts to go deeper and further. We have brought our Ignatian spirituality, our reflective capacities, some of our international resources to bear. Good results are evident. For example, in the decree Jesuits and University Life of the last General Congregation, and in this very conference on commitment to justice in Jesuit higher education, good results are noted and are hoped for the Higher Education Committee working on Jesuit criteria. Paraphrasing Ignazio e la Curia, it is the nature of every university to be a social force. And it is the calling of a Jesuit university to take conscious responsibility for being such a force for faith and justice. Every Jesuit academy of higher learning is called to live in a social reality and to live for that social reality, to shed university intelligence upon it and to use university influence to transform it. Jesuit universities have stronger and different reasons than maybe other academic and research institutions for addressing the actual world as it unjustly exists and for helping to reshape it in the light of the gospel. And now, in conclusion. The 25th anniversary of the 32nd General Congregation is a motive for great thanksgiving. We give thanks for our Jesuit University awareness of the world in its entirety and in its ultimate depth, created yet abused, sinful yet redeemed, and we take up our Jesuit University responsibility for human society that is so scandalously unjust, so complex to understand, and so hard to change. With the help of others, and especially the poor, we want to play our role as students, as teachers and researchers, and as Jesuit University in human society. As Jesuit higher education, we embrace new ways of learning and being formed in the pursuit of adult solidarity, new methods of researching and teaching in an academic community of dialogue, and a new university way of practicing faith justice in society. As we assume our Jesuit university characteristics in the new century, we do so with seriousness and hope. For this very mission has already produced martyrs who prove that an institution of higher learning and research can really become an instrument of justice in the name of the gospel. But implementing it is not something a Jesuit university accomplishes once and for all. It is rather an ideal to keep taking up and working at, a cluster of characteristics to keep exploring and implementing, a conversion to keep praying for. In the now famous document Ex Corde Ecclesiae, John Paul II charges Catholic universities with a challenging agenda for teaching, research, and service when he writes, "The dignity of human life, the promotion of justice for all, the quality of personal and family life, the protection of nature, the search for peace and political stability, a more just sharing in the world's resources, and a new economic and political order that will better serve the human community at a national and international level, are both high ideals and concrete tasks of the university. I encourage our Jesuit colleges and universities to take them up with critical understanding and deep conviction, with faith and much hope in the early years of the new century. The way to faith and the way to justice are inseparable ways. It is up this undivided road, this steep road, that the Pilgrim Church, the Society of Jesus, the Jesuit University and College must travel and toil. Faith and justice are undivided in the gospel, which teaches that faith makes its power felt through love. They cannot therefore be divided in our purpose, our action, our life, for the greater glory of God. Thank you very much.